Yeah, it, like, it's very informal. Robert Jay Lifton, thank you so much for everything you've contributed to the planet and to me personally. And I really treasure this opportunity to see you again.
Well, I'm happy to see you and to talk with you.
Yeah, and last time we met, we chatted about your memoir, but I wanted the opportunity to learn more and to record you whatever kernels of wisdom, of information, of reflection that you'd like to share. And if not, just chat.
Okay. Let's call it the latter.
Okay, a chat.
Okay.
So one thing that people in my specific area, I'm just petting your dog, have brought up to me over and over again is, of course, your seminal work, Thought Reform and the Psychology of Totalism, which was published, well, at least in paperback, in 1961. And I've encountered cult apologists, cult members, who say, well, you never commented about cults. And they said, wrong. You wrote a book, Destroying the World to Save It, about Aum Shinrikyo.
Right, but there were decades in between.
Right.
And it's true that when I wrote my book on thought reform, and one has to always apologize for that long, laborious title, but one maybe does that with one's first book. Anyhow, when I wrote that book, it is true, I hadn't had any experience with cults or people who had belonged to them. But I did try to hone in on the idea of totalism, or, you know, the psychological equivalent of totalitarianism and all or none belief systems which claim omniscience and absolute virtue. That to me seemed not just a Chinese phenomenon, but a worldwide problem. And when the problem was, when the issue was returned to me in relation to cults, I was at first surprised because I hadn't studied cults, but then when I learned what went on in many cultic groups, it seemed quite appropriate, because totalism is not limited to any group, and it's a profound world danger. Right now, it is as much as any time in human history. So it was applied to cults, and then later, of course, I became interested in cultic movements and their own versions of totalism, and had a good chance to study one such movement hands-on, Aum Shinrikyo, which you mentioned. That was not until the mid and late 1990s, but...
That's the Japanese sarin gas cult.
Yeah, that's right, the Japanese extremist religious cult that is known mostly for releasing sarin gas into the Tokyo subway system. It's a cult that gave rise to terrorism. But, you know, we were just talking before how impressive it was to me that when I interviewed young people, and they were bright young people, university students and graduates, who had been in that cult and had been out of it for a year or more. I interviewed them in Tokyo. It was really striking how some of them would say to me, you know, I know that Aum moved into criminal directions and I condemn that, they would say, but I still miss those experiences with the guru, what they called mystical experiences, which were, in a way, programmed or manipulated by the guru and his assistants, but, you know, heavy breathing in which you deoxygenate, and then sometimes use of drugs also, and then, and then they had high states in which they would imagine themselves merging with the guru, fantasy of total merger with the guru, which is probably not unusual in cultic groups, but was particularly intense with Aum Shinrikyo. And they had no experience so intense and satisfying before or since.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a real lesson in how powerful the cultic group can be in its penetration of the psyche.
Yeah, and if I can quote your book, Thought Reform and the Psychology of Totalism, you said in chapter 22, I believe, that even the most totalist environment can become a valuable life-enlarging environment if the person has the inner capacity to make use of the pressures and the ability to leave the environment.
That's
a paraphrase.
Yes, I would slightly modify that. I mean, yes, I mostly did say that, but it isn't so much even the most totalistic environment, the most extreme environments, the most extremely totalistic environments are suffocating. Yeah. But there are environments that may be near totalistic, say, I don't know, some forms of Jesuit training or some graduate training.
Mm-hmm.
And they may be beneficial as long as there's some fresh air you can come out to,
mm-hmm.
so that one isn't absolutely immersed in their claim to truth, but they have some balance between the intensity of that claim and the outside world.
Right.
That can be beneficial. But in this case, it was a longing for an intensity of a psychic experience that's very hard to match and has deep appeal.
Right.
And I think that these high states, I mean, you can get them in other forms. They're classical states for the mystics,
right.
Not just contemporary cults, religious mystics in all centuries. And they are a valid form of human experience, part of the human repertoire. In some ways, people hunger for them.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps don't have too many opportunities for them. They can be experienced in other ways, even in sexual behavior, in everyday sense, can afford a high state where one is transported from the banality of ordinary everyday life, or sports, athletics. It's been described as perhaps childbirth can be such a moment. So there are other expressions of high states, but they're not perhaps encouraged and in some ways discouraged in our society, and they can be deeply valued and embraced when they're offered.
Right.
And that could be dangerous when they're tied in with some form of destructive behavior and a totalistic environment.
Right. I can tell you that many of my clients over the years expressed similar feelings, that they never felt the highs, they never felt the overwhelming clarity of totalist involvement, including myself in the Moonies, where it's a suspension of all noise, with all discordant thoughts, extraneous, ambivalent feelings and such, to think you're at the key moment in human history between God and Satan, and all the forces of good and evil are balanced on you and your relationship with the divine. It's
you're giving a good description of the mystical experience in general.
Yeah.
And then a key issue is, okay, you have that high state which is so powerful and treasured.
Mm-hmm.
What do you come down to?
Yeah.
What do you come down to? Do you come down to an environment that's suffocating and manipulates that high state in your psyche?
Right.
Or an environment that values it, but offers the world as well, in some sense, or at least an opening to the world?
Right. Well, there's so many things I want to say in response to that, but I guess the first thing I want to say is just how many people I've met who are former members, some in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years in a cult group, and then they wake up in the sense of realizing that the leader is flawed or a rapist or a criminal, as in the case of Shoko Asahara. Kind of feeling the need to throw the baby out with the bathwater, in the sense of afraid to open a Bible ever again, or afraid to meditate, or afraid to allow themselves the freedom to explore mysticism again, or spirituality.
They've been burned.
Exactly. And I wonder if you have any thoughts about that for anyone listening to this video. Because the people's sense of trust is so
my sense is that, I don't know, you can tell me whether this is true with the people that you've interviewed, but over time, as they get back in the world and away from the narrow, closed environment of the cult, yes, they may be wary of high states in general, but I wonder whether they can, in many cases, gradually find their way to a balance. Just being struck by beauty, intense beauty, a wonderful sunset, or looking at the ocean, what Freud and others call the oceanic state, is some sort of or what I call the experience of transcendence, we need such experiences. And I think some of these people you talk about, as they recover from the closed, and as they feel their way free of the closed environment they've been in, they can become free to again experience some of the more powerful forms of psychic experience, or the experience of transcendence. But much would be lost if that were eliminated from any lives.
Agreed. But I guess I want to bring up a concept that I think you wrote about in The Nazi Doctors for the first time, Dublin.
Right.
And in my experience with myself and the people that I work with coming out of these groups, is the sense of that when they came out, their real self re-emerged, their cult self got put underneath, and in many ways, even if they were in 20 years, their psychological age was what it was before they went in.
Yeah.
And that unless they're able to do the inner mining of their experiences and integrating it, they're very split.
And they can
easily get triggered by a stressor like a tsunami wave or some threat of war. And it's a frightful kind of dual reality, because you know you don't believe in the guru anymore, and yet that identity
comes back. Well, what I think is that, I came to the idea of Dublin. I wanted to talk about a form of splitting that was that gave one two functional selves within the same self. And I was struck, and this is another way of saying what you just said, when people came out of cults and for various reasons would join, say, their parents or their non-cultic friends, say it's a legal case, at their bench or in their group, they could almost, now this is oversimplifying it, but very quickly, they had their doubts before, and that's how the whole thing came up, but they could rather suddenly revert to their prior self. The difficulty, as you say, is that first of all, you can't revert completely to that prior self. You've been through a whole experience that has to be in some way coped with. It has to be absorbed. And when I think people have successful forms of emerging from totalism, it isn't the prior self they return to literally. It's lots of elements of the prior self, along with some kind of experience they've had in that cult or in life in general. So it's a third place.
Yeah.
They have to do that work of transition in order for the new version or the renewal to really take shape.
Yeah, that's true. I would agree with that in terms of. And just, I guess I wanted to, for those who haven't read Nazi Doctors, just spell out that you were studying doctors, medical doctors who were committed to life, doing the most horrendous atrocities during the day, coming home and playing with their children, and everything was normal. And
they could be Nazi doctors in Auschwitz were involved in the killing. Mm. They were socialized to, adapted to the norm of the Nazis, which was killing Jews and others. In any case, so they would function as Nazi doctors involved in the killing for 5 or 6 days a week in Auschwitz. Then they'd go home on leave for a long weekend or a Nazi version of R&R and be relatively ordinary fathers and husbands. And I thought about this and came to the idea that they formed a second self, or it was an aspect of doubling. But then I quickly realized it wasn't only Nazi doctors, even prisoners in Auschwitz or Jews in Nazi camps, they would say when they came out, I was a different person in Auschwitz.
Yeah.
And you had to be a different person because you had to cope with all kinds of cruelty and brutality in a way that isn't necessary or seemingly possible in other environments.
Exactly.
So doubling, again, is part of the human repertoire. It can be in some ways useful, as perhaps with prisoners in camps, but of course it can be very harmful. It was a means by which Nazi doctors could adapt to evil, to committing evil.
Right.
But it's, you know, I think it's a useful way to think of people who have this intense cultic immersion and seek to overcome it. It's still part of their psyches, but it's subsumed. It's no longer dominant,
right,
to the emerging self.
Yeah. I'm actually working with a client who's been out of a Bible cult for 15 years, who's been hospitalized 10 times, suicidal, tadic, who has described an entity that comes at night that tells her she needs to die.
Yeah.
And in my first session, she's read my first book, and my first session with her, I asked her to entertain the idea that maybe this entity is related to the part of her that was a leader in this Bible cult.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that the beliefs were, if you leave the group, you're going to Satan.
Of course.
And it's better to
of
die.
Of course, yeah.
And it seemed like her eyes lit up to have some understanding.
Because the whole issue of guilt is so central to those who control totalistic environments. The manipulation of guilt is crucial to it. And it becomes the whole world as defined, at least the acceptable world.
Mm-hmm.
And one is condemned to remain guilt-ridden, or even, as you say, to condemned to die in one's own fears if one leaves or contests it.
Well, that's your eighth point, is dispensing of existence.
Yeah.
This idea that if you're part of the group, you have a right to exist.
Yeah.
And if you're out, then...
And in that dispensing of existence, that, of course, relationship with the guru is all powerful, because it's the guru who's likely, or those who talk in his name and his system, or her, who is likely to be the source of all existence and has the ultimate power to dispense it. And, you know, with that idea, it could be anything from the most extreme version of the Nazis or the communists deciding in turn that Jews or gypsies all had to be murdered, couldn't have the right to exist, or the communists saying the same about peasants or those accused of various crimes falsely, or in much more everyday ways, whether one has a right to carry through one's life or be a leader in some other area. It's perhaps the most malignant of what I made, the 8 points that I expressed.
Well, it did sum up the all or nothingness of the being question.
Yes.
And you're in or you're out, and of course then the justification of doing violence or harming anyone or harming yourself.
Yes, it's the culmination
of
that all or nothing idea.
So I wonder if I can ask you to just say a few words about some of your 8 points, and hopefully I'll remember them all, having done this work for 36 years.
Probably so remember them better than
you. You talked about milieu control, the control of human communication, and how it becomes part of the person's communication within themselves.
It seems that the first thing that a totalistic leader, totalist environment, imposes is control of communication in the environment. And it's a very simple idea. Perhaps it becomes harder and harder to do with our various technologies, but you can see how totalistic environments try their damnedest to do it,
right?
Whether it's shutting down the internet or suppressing various media. Control of the environment is crucial for setting up the totalistic action of the environment. And that's such a universal kind of impulse. And I don't know, with all the American imperfections, imperfections seem to be becoming more and more manifest, this openness to an environment is a kind of blessing. And one of the big problems is that there are all too many Americans and others who want to close down things more,
because they think they know better.
So they think they have absolute truth.
Yeah, and they're going to protect everyone else from.
So, in that sense, milieu control simply means control of communication, and control of communication is can run deep.
Mm-hmm.
Can run very deep, and it's also in keeping with what I consider to be the power of the group. You know, in the various destructive things I've studied, I've learned how important an immediate environment that's strong and totalistic can be in determining behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And milieu control is the absolute necessity and beginning basis for everything.
Right. And what about mystical manipulation?
Yeah, that's... maybe that's less thought about because, I mentioned these young people who had been in Aum Shinrikyo, and they experienced what felt like a beautiful mystical experience.
Mm-hmm.
It was, of course, systematically manipulated by those in charge for their purposes or to really affirm what they took to be ultimate truth. Often with conviction that they were doing a wonderful thing.
So
I think discovering the manipulative part of it becomes crucial to overcoming totalism, and at some point necessary to freeing oneself from that control.
Right. So for me, one thing that I discovered as I kept doing more and more work with people was asking them to reflect back on one of the early experiences that caused them to believe that they needed to devote themselves to the guru or something. And it almost always came back to some misattribution phenomenon, whether it was, I describe in one of my books, somebody saying he saw the guru with emanating a golden light in an aura, and then understanding that he was listening to a meditation tape for hours and hours and hours where the guru said, and when you're ready to see your teacher, you will see the golden light. And just making the connection and saying, there's a hypnotic phenomenon,
that's
hypnotic
right.
suggestion, that could explain this experience, which at first he said, no, it was definitely spiritual. But as I explained that it can be recreated, it opened the door for him to reconsider.
There can be a fine line in experiences of spiritual intensity, what we call high states, that are spontaneous or genuine, and those that are manipulated. Where the experience is so strong, one can lose all concern about whether they're manipulated or not. But there can be that fine line, and so this becomes a really important and demanding area of thought, I would say.
Yeah,
this mystical manipulation.
And another very common one that I've encountered is where the recruiter finds out all kinds of personal details about the person's background, and then reports it to the lecturer, who just happens to be giving, you know, a talk from the Bible on that very subject, and makes the extra long eye contact after the prayer that God should use us to speak to our hearts.
So the manipulative side can be studied, systematic, and effective.
Yeah. And so let's go on. How about sacred science? Yeah.
Well, in a way, that I mean, that's, I think, exemplified by many different cults. It was very vivid with Om Shinrikyo. One wants this truth to be not only spiritually ultimate, but to be a kind of absolute scientific truth as well. And they can have a kind of kernel of support by sometimes, for instance, studying and finding, as indeed scientific studies sometimes show, that meditation can, you know, lower the pulse rate improve mood over time, and do some good things in relationship to high blood pressure and other conditions, you know, that are affected by stress. But the totalist wants to go further. The aim here is to, in a scientific age, get the blessing of what's now considered the ultimate form of knowledge as applying to that guru's worldview and claims. And in that sense, there's an effort to merge mysticism and science. And you have to really be careful to observe that.
Yeah, people forget that science is about having a hypothesis and then testing it, and not just, and being ready to abandon the hypothesis as more evidence.
That's right, it's a cast of mind, and it's about respecting evidence. Sometimes, as in the case again of these young people who were so affected by Asahara in Om Shinrikyo, they have evidence of their having thrived in that cult in relation to mystical states. That's hard for them to toss away. They have to also look at evidence in terms of what happened to people and what the criminal behavior, secret, making crude chemical and biological weapons and killing people as they did. But the claim to science is, what you might say, an upcoming claim of cultic groups.
You've heard about the secret and the scientific law that if you believe something 100%, the universe will deliver it to you, whether it's a Porsche or
I see.
That's sexy girlfriend. But you have to believe it 100%.
Yeah.
It's a secret law, scientific law of the universe.
Yes, and again, there may be a slight kernel of truth in that if one has a passion and a will, one can sometimes create something that one desires deeply.
Yeah.
But that's a little, when I say that, I'm talking about the way the psyche works, rather than a law of the psyche, exactly. The law of the universe.
Exactly. So let's see how my memory's doing. What about demand for purity?
Yeah. What characterizes most of our lives is a kind of complexity. You know, we do certain things in the morning, we do different things in the middle of the day and at night, and the things that we do all day become encumbered by alternative possibilities and disagreements. I think there can be a human yearning for simplicity, for greater simplicity, and that yearning is carried to an extreme with the kind of purity that can seem to be achieved in totalism. So that totalistic groups are never big on nuance. They claim to, and can for a while, seem to overcome all doubt, all nuance, everything that's amorphous, in the service of absolute purity and clarity, as you were discussing before. And the purity can have a considerable appeal because it can seem to relieve one of doubt. And perhaps it can relieve one of uneasy emotions having to do with guilt, at least for a period of time, or having to do with some sort of uncertainty.
But I would also, in my recollection in terms of your criteria, was that it was more directed towards manipulating the criteria of shame and guilt, and like always raising the bar so people were never good enough. They had to keep working harder and harder and harder.
Your guilt and your shame could be tapped and tapped by the guru of a totalistic community because it's never sufficiently pure. In that sense, there's always more to confess.
Exactly. We're going to get to confession next.
That's
right. Maybe you can mention that.
Right. So the cult of purity keeps you constantly uncertain in your standing and constantly failing.
You're right, you're never good enough.
In relation to the perfection that purity represents.
Right, right. And in the cult of confession, you talked about how you have to note secrets, you have to reveal, whether in group or in individual, everything of your interior life, kind of breaking down the boundaries of the normal sense of self.
Again, confession is a universal human form of expression, and you can find it everywhere. I've learned something useful about confession. If I'm stopped by a policeman for some sort of violation, rather than argue with him and say I didn't do it, my mode is, I'm terribly sorry, officer.
Right.
I did something I shouldn't have done. I'll try to avoid doing it again.
Right.
And usually that can get one off the hook because the confession is a complete submissiveness toward authority.
Exactly.
And confession can be that. There's a healthy interest in false confession that has taken shape in the society among legal groups and even among humanistic groups.
Right.
A friend of mine, Peter Brooks, has written, who's a student of literature, has written about false confessions in law situations. Yeah. And you know, I'm fond of quoting the statement by Camus in his novel, in one of his novels, The Fall, in which he has his protagonist say, I confess and confess in order to avoid telling what I know. Now, I don't think that a person subjected to constant confession, continuous confession, totalist environment, is aware that he's or she is holding back something he knows. Mm-hmm. But there's a sense that there's a sense in which that confession process, when pressured in that way, mm-hmm. is falsified.
Oh, yeah.
And presses toward false information. Mm-hmm. And some deeper truth is covered over and hidden by it.
Yeah, and I would say that with the modern police departments videotaping interrogations, they've actually been able to demonstrate how the police officers were basically doing thought reform on the people, their memories. And
or at least the confession breakdown.
Yeah.
And that part, the Chinese communists took in good part from the Soviets, who mm-hmm. Carried through a lot of confession extraction, and people studied the mm-hmm. confessions the Soviets extracted, and many were false. Mm-hmm. And the ultimate submission was the belief in false confession, mm-hmm. which again some of the people that the Soviets broke down could come to believe, at least temporarily, and which I encountered mm-hmm. in some people, at least temporarily, subjected to Chinese thought.
Right. So you've been very gracious with your time. I don't want to delay you longer than need be, but I guess I just want to ask you an open-ended question about, now that we're in 2012, we're looking at the world, we're looking at an ever-increasing internet war where it seems cyber terrorism is the strategy. Now it seems there's much more focus on functional MRIs and the neuroscience of how the mind works, and I'm just wondering about your reflections on.
Well, the way I would see it is, it's wonderful to be able to become so advanced in brain imagery mm-hmm. and in brain imaging, because then you can observe the impact on the brain of certain emotions, or the simultaneous brainwave changes with right. emotional expression. But it becomes misleading if one then comes to see all of psychological behavior as merely a function of the brain in some material way.
Mm-hmm.
It's true you can't have psychological experience without a brain.
Right.
It's crucial. But there still is a subject of mind.
Absolutely.
that we must be concerned with, and I think the wiser neuroscientists are aware of this.
Mm-hmm.
And the exciting possibility, which perhaps is in the very beginning way being realized, is combining the two
right.
and carrying through brain research in a way that continues respect for
right.
this extraordinary organ we call the mind, which can be the source of so much wonder and so much mischief.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the planet seems to be getting smaller, in the sense that some event in China, for the first time that I'm aware of, there were two demonstrations in mainland China against some waste management project. The masses came out and demonstrated, and instead of squashing them, they capitulated to them and stopped the project. And I thought that was extraordinary.
It's interesting to look at China. You know, when I did my study, it was the mid-50s, my first study, China was turned in on itself. It was ideologically as extreme as one can imagine a whole country, and it was obsessed with thought reform.
Mm-hmm.
With ideological convictions mm-hmm. that were laid out in thought reform and pressed mm-hmm. home very intensely in thought reform. In a half century now, since that time, a little more, China has become a country in which virtually no one believes in its ideology. Mm. The government, which was purist at the time, is now as corrupt as any government in the world. Mm-hmm. And with modes of communication and the internet, it's increasingly difficult for the Chinese to there still is a totalistic core mm-hmm. in terms of their governance.
Right.
But the rest of society has exploded outward in various ways. And one thing, I might have mentioned this to you before, that was interesting about my whole experience with studying thought reform in China and then studying the Cultural Revolution later on. The Chinese over-reformed.
Mm-hmm.
People got sick of being reformed.
Mm-hmm.
There is a limit to the impact that a thought reform-like procedure can have.
Uh-huh.
That's, broadly speaking, good news.
Yes, exactly.
For humankind. There is a craving for some kind of freedom of the mind, for some kind of openness mm-hmm. in environments. But the Chinese couldn't stop themselves from reforming mm-hmm. for a long time because they were a religious-like movement, even though a highly politicized one. And now, you know, the thought reform is still around, but it seems to be more punitive. It's much less systematically applied, mm-hmm. but it's there behind the scenes as a possible form of punishment, either thought reform or so-called reform by labor, which might be mm-hmm. a little worse physically.
Mm-hmm.
But the Chinese journey, it can be very discouraging, and it's hard when you're a Chinese dissident because they clamp down heavily and ruthlessly. But there's something encouraging also about that country. 50 years seems like a long time, but it's a fairly short historical span for that degree of change.
Yeah, it's amazing, actually. I have so many different thoughts that you're generating. I guess I want to just bring back a theme that I remember from your book about the underlying vulnerability of human beings to the authority figure. If my memory is correct, you were talking about this childlike yearning for the perfect parental authority figure that we all get disillusioned when we grow up and we see our parents aren't.
Well, I was struck by the kind of widespread vulnerability that I encountered and the hunger
mm-hmm.
for authority and for, in many cases, absolute authority.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked myself, where does it come from? Why can't we just be balanced people all the way through and not need anything more?
Mm-hmm.
And when I wrote that first book, I came to a series of thoughts. They were not so original, and I would still think they're, reasonably valid, and it has to do with the long human period of dependency. You know, our young children are dependent upon us until pretty much they reach adulthood. Doesn't necessarily stop there either. But in any case, that's unusual
mm-hmm.
and maybe unique in terms of animal life. And in that way, there has to be a potential for resurgence of those dependency needs and a hunger, a longing for some version of parental authority, or what I call the omnipotent guide.
Right.
So that does seem to be an important issue. And then later on, when I became more preoccupied with issues of life and death through my work in Hiroshima and elsewhere, there is the equally obvious but still all important human, the theme of human mortality. Being the animal who knows that we die gives us a certain edge. I think it gives us our creative force, but also our vulnerability to those who promise us a form of immortal life. One essential, I think, characteristic of a guru who's functioning as a guru and functioning effectively in convincing people mm-hmm. to live by his tenets is that he seems to offer in his very personhood a promise of immortality, a promise of something that lives on more or less forever as compared to humdrum ordinary life where there's no such promise. And in my work I've written a lot about what I call the sense of immortality, the sense we all require being part of something larger than ourselves, and it doesn't have to be in a mystical form, it could be just in being part of something that existed before we arrived and will exist presumably after we leave this earth. But
like our works, like children.
That's right, our work or our families, mm-hmm. and sometimes through religion, but it doesn't have to be through a totalistic religion, it can be through the remarkable human experience as a cultural animal where we're parts of culture that existed a long time ago and will definitely continue. So a guru offers that promise, and it's very tempting in the face of death and all the anxiety about death that we have.
Right.
And that's another crucial aspect, I think, of guru behavior, guruhood, and totalism.
Yeah. And I would also say, in terms of the clients I've worked with, and I was only involved for 2.5 years because I fell asleep at the wheel of a van and I had an intervention to get out of the moonies, but for the people who were involved for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, they too got disillusioned because they could hear the prophecies and they wouldn't come true and see the hypocrisies over and over again. And so at a certain point, it lost its magic and it became more of a job, and then eventually it's suffocating.
Yes, and of course I'm sure you've observed how long in some cases people can suppress their doubts. The doubts can be very strong. You know, it's a funny kind of association, but in a whole other area, I talk of what I call the retirement syndrome. For instance, people who, you know, one of my passions is opposition to nuclear weapons, and people who have advocated, broadly speaking, nuclearism, nuclear weapons, may spend their lives building them up, and at their moment of retirement, where they're no longer in that environment, they can say very wise things about nuclear weapons and their danger. They can lift that suppression of their doubts, and then they know better than anyone else what these weapons can do. And there's something about a person coming out of a cult that is parallel to that retirement syndrome. Once there is let in some further encouragement or possibility for returning to those doubts, they can, you know, they can pour out like a geyser,
right,
because they've been there and they've been suppressed for so long.
Right. I think a key point is just, you know, access to others that are of a different point of view, that former members, if you, someone comes out and finally confronts the enemy who was hated for so many decades, and then they, like for me, they think I have horns, and then they meet me and all of a sudden I normalize, you can have a life if you leave the cult, you know?
Yeah,
it was okay.
Yeah.
And if, you know, there is existence outside of the group. So it challenges the phobia that was, in a sense, installed, that this dispensing of existence.
They were so long afraid to lift that suppression of doubts because they'd be damned or condemned or all the other threats, and I suppose after a period of time they don't know much of a world outside the cult, at least as adults, in some cases.
Yeah, the wiring was, I mean, I was out of the moonies for 4 years before I made the connection cognitively of having been shown the Exorcist movie in 1974 with 300 other Moonies, and then Moon saying, God made this movie, this movie's a prophecy of what will happen to you if you leave the unification. Vacation Church.
Yeah.
I was out of the group for 4 years, and then I, as I was studying phobias, I went, oh, that's where, that was the point where I started distrusting my own ability to think, and every time I had a doubt, it was an evil spirit trying to invade me.
So well, there can be a period of time where, this is a key to what you just said, when the fear of one's doubts taking over is so great that the greater the doubt, the more extreme one's effort to cover it over, and the more extreme one's new plunge into the totalistic environment may be.
Right.
That occurred with people undergoing Chinese thought reform.
Right. So I want to express my gratitude one more time for all of your work and for you personally on that fateful day. And I want to just remind you, at least, because I have a very clear memory of it. I called you up. You were at Yale, and I spoke with your secretary, and I'm blocking on her name, but she was with you for decades.
Probably Lily Finn.
Yes. Yeah. And I said, I just got out of this cult, and I would really like to talk to Dr. Lifton. And you got on the phone, and you said, you know, what do you want to talk to me about? I said, thought reform and the psychology of totalism. And you said, that old book? why could you possibly want to talk to me about? And I said, because I was in this group, and they helped me get out. And you said, come meet me. And then I started...
When you said that, I think it seemed quite interesting to me that somebody in a cult would embrace that book on thought reform, and the connection would be there.
Yeah, it was 1976. You were like, that old book? And then when I explained the 3-day workshop, the 7-day workshop, the 21-day workshop, 40-day workshop, you said, Steve, this is much more sophisticated than what I studied, and you said this is like a virulent mutation of a dangerous strain, and here's the kicker that changed my life. You said, you know, I just studied the second hand, but you lived it.
Yeah.
They did it to you, and you did it to others, so you need to study psychology and explain it to people like me.
Yeah.
And I was a college dropout, ex-Mooney, totally depressed, and this eminent world-famous psychiatrist from Yale was saying, hey, you have something to share.
Yeah, and you shared it with me, so...
who knew?
We were learning from each other.
Yeah, no, who knew that 36 years later...
Well, it's nice to hear that your life was so
effective. So my profound gratitude, and my wife and my son, and all of your good work. I'm so pleased to have this opportunity to videotape this so we can put it on the internet for people to watch forevermore.
And well.
And I thank you.
I've enjoyed our talk, as I always do.
Yeah, thanks. Any last words before? Did you want to ask anything?
No,
that's great. Fantastic. Thank you.
You're very welcome.